Umaga po sa inyo, maupay nga aga ha inyo nga tanan.
Good morning to all of you. Thank you very much, Director, Region 8 Director Leonardo Sibaluca, for that very kind introduction. Secretary Manny de Guzman of the Climate Change Commission, a commission which I created by law, which I will tell you about later. I will not read my speech, but you can just play the pictures and the PowerPoint, but I will just extemporize. CDA Chairman Orlando Ravanera, NRENB Director Gilbert Gonzalez, Palo Mayor Martin Petilia, very old friend, Vice Mayor Yaucasin Tambo, should be here with us and join us, yes. And of course, I am here because a good friend, a co-advocate of climate change mitigation and adaptation, has embraced it as his lifelong cause, being a survivor of Typhoon Haiyan, Pete Ilagan. Don't worry, Pete, I will make your dreams come true. You might fall off your seat when I announce what I will say later, that's why I will not read my speech. Dr. Yulito Casas, Junior Chairman of the Philippine Haiyan Advocacy Cooperative. Oh, there, yes. I will make your message come true today. So, and our representative of Mayor Kring, who is in this post today, I have a speech to read. I can just email you my speech or distribute the hard copy. All of the local government officials from various LGUs in Region 8, tayo po ang ating mga mayor para makita ko po kayo. San po ang ating mga mayor? Raise your hand. I want to see mayors, vice mayors, councilors, representatives of LGUs present here, media, people's organizations, civil society organizations. This meeting is so important. This meeting is very historic. This meeting is very timely. Just 3 weeks from now, we commemorate a very sad, unfortunate tragedy in the history of our nation and of the world. But what the people of Tacloban, of Palok, of Leyte, of Region 8 have shown us that we are able to transform our tragedy, our sadness, the unfortunate circumstances into positive, urgent climate action. And I believe this is what drives and inspires the Philippine Haiyan Advocacy Cooperative. Dr. Casas, Pete, I am with you in your endeavor. Allow me to lend my wisdom, my expertise, my time, and my resources in the next 3 years as senator and beyond to help you in pushing, mobilizing, inspiring, compelling local governments and people's grassroots organization to embrace climate change mitigation and adaptation as a lifelong cause that is a matter of survival for our nation and our citizenry. So, mag-volunteer na ako sa inyo. Why is it so important? Because every ounce of preparedness or disaster risk reduction can save lives. It is said that for every dollar invested in preparedness or DRR, you save $7 from potential economic losses. Ibig pong sabihin, pag tayo ay handa, ay mababawasan ang pinsala. Alam naman natin yan. In simple operational terms, what does it mean? In terms of building design, when we build our structures to be safer, when we abide by local and national ordinances on the building code. When we build according to the strength of the potential wind, we rebuild in areas which are not vulnerable areas. When we build, and before we build, we check with the Mines and Geosciences Bureau if it is not a geohazard area. If we take this into consideration and do multi-hazard risk assessment, then we are assured that a structure can withstand any natural hazard. It is said that natural hazards do not have to turn into disasters if we are prepared. Mababawasan ang ating pinsala, ang kawalan, ang kamatayan, ang kakulangan pag tayo ay susunod sa mga batas at batas ng kalikasan. Pag ang struktura natin ay tama ang pagagawa at hindi tinayo sa lugar na sinasabi ng ating mga inhenyero na delikadong lugar, ay hindi matatamaan ng storm surge, ng tsunami, ng baha, ng sobrang ulan. So, abiding by our building code and doing a geohazard assessment, in fact, multi-hazard assessment, and following the risk assessment and capacitating people and LGUs, participatory risk governance. That's what the Climate Change Commission does as many of their training modules. Ibig sabihin po, ang bawat lokal na pamahalaan ay dapat, bawat mayor, syudad man o munisipyo, ay dapat alam ano ba ang risk sa ating lugar. Kung maganda ang bawat barangay, 42,000, alam niya dapat ano ba ang risk. Ako ay sa may baybay, ako ay sa may bundok, malambot ang lupa, ilang oras lang ng ulan. Ako ay mababa, Del Valley, o ako ay mataas, baka gumuho ang bundok. We should know our risks because we will only be able to prepare if we know our risks. So risk assessment is very important. And this risk assessment cannot be done by the mayor alone. It has to be with the participation of the community. That's why it is participatory risk governance. When we know our risks from various natural hazards, we are able to prepare. And so every city and municipality, every province, must have a DRR officer, which is enshrined in our National Disaster Risk Reduction Management Law, which I also co-authored and co-sponsored. This is a six-year-old law which mandates the National Disaster Risk Reduction Management Council must help local governments and their DRR officers, so that these DRR officers must be able to help barangay captains and kagawads and teachers and students and everyone to be more aware and how to prepare for these hazards. So, if your city or your municipality still does not have a DRR officer, you must have one under the NDRIM law. So the existence of a DRR officer, the use of risk assessment, these are two very important aspects. Third, I mentioned about the Climate Change Commission. The Vice Chair, Secretary Manny de Guzman, is here. It was in 2007 when I first wrote the bill. Pinaniginipan ko ito I literally dreamt about it. Remember, that was 2007. But even before 2007, even when I was a young journalist 30 years ago, I have been advocating for climate change mitigation and adaptation. But during the time, people did not seem to understand me or even recognize the efforts. But never mind. And so, when I was a young senator in 1998, I authored the Clean Air Act in 1998, the Clean Water Act in 2003, and the Ecological Solid Waste Management Law, or 9003, in 2001 after the Payatas tragedy in Quezon City. On my second term in 2007, I said, I already did clean air and clean water and solid waste. Now, I will do something for climate. And I anticipated that we would have stronger, gustier winds, more intense typhoons, longer, drier droughts. And with that extreme weather events, we would have hunger, starvation, scarcity of water, vector-borne diseases, women and children and the elderly and the disabled, the vulnerable sector, including our indigenous people. And so I must prepare the nation for this. That is why I wrote the climate change law. It was in 2007 when I wrote it. It was in 2009 when we enacted it into law. It was in 2010 when it was signed. 2011, it was implemented. Now it is one of the youngest, bunso, one of the youngest commissions of the government, barely 5 years old in operation. So this happened when Ondoy hit Metro Manila and Luzon. It was during Ondoy that Congress and the Senate were awakened to my advocacy against climate change. And then Typhoon Pablo happened in Region 11. And then Sendong happened in Region 10 in Cagayan de Oro. And then Habagat and all of that happened. And then in 2013, November 8, Hayan, Yolanda struck Leyte and Region 8 and actually 40 provinces in the country. And I felt and I knew that indeed the Climate Change Act was timely, relevant, and urgent and must be put at the center of governance. The Climate Change Act created the Commission on Climate Change. The Commission on Climate Change is chaired by no less than the President of the Republic of the Philippines, vice-chaired by one commissioner with two other commissioners. It is the mandate of the Climate Change Commission to help local governments create their local climate action plan, to do capacity building efforts so that each LGU will be helped build capacity to know their vulnerabilities and their risks and to build their resilience against these risks and hazards. The Climate Change Commission already has the National Climate Change Action Plan and should capacitate local governments. So, with the NDREAM-C law, which mandates a DRR officer in every LGU, with the Climate Change Act on a national level, helping local governments have their local action plan, and having every environmental law in place, what else do we need? Which is the most important? Local climate action. All these laws, which I wrote, which I have enacted in my 3 terms as senator, will all be ink on paper. Wala pong saysay at silbi ang aking pinaghirapan kung hindi po ipapatupad ng ating mga lokal na pamahalaan, ang mga people's organizations, at ng ating mga kababayan. all these well-intended laws will be useless if it is not understood and not implemented by our local governments. And so I am deeply appreciative of the efforts of advocacy groups in the private sector which should help government. And that's the reason why I'm here, and that's the reason why I will support and continue to support such efforts, because we in the national government cannot do it alone. And even local governments need the help. We see the passion and the drive with Philippine Hayan Advocacy Cooperative, and I think that sessions like this should be replicated in other areas of Region 8 and beyond. In fact, I believe that Region 8 must be the center of resilience, because you know how it feels to be a climate victim, because we know that climate injustice exists. The Philippines, being in the top three most vulnerable nations in the world, is only a 0.03 emitter in the world, meaning we are not the cause of greenhouse gas emissions in the world. The United States, the European Union, China, India, other countries have caused the greenhouse gas emissions, but we in the Philippines, a non-emitter in the world, bears the brunt of disaster losses and of vulnerabilities, and we must learn to adapt. We must also mitigate, even if you are not an emitter, but we must learn to adapt. That's why, what is adaptation? The planting of mangroves, seagrass beds, where and when applicable. The planting of your talisay trees, Pit Ilagan, where applicable. That's why the role of Director Leonardo is so important, so that every area by the bay, by the sea, where mangroves must be planted as natural buffers against storm surge, that must be done. The creation or building of seawalls, concrete, are important, but they're expensive. If we can just have a massive mangrove, seagrass reforestation in every area that is available, these are the natural buffers against storm surge. If only people knew what storm surge meant in Bisaya, or Tagalog, or Waray. If only Pag-asa at the time explained the height of the storm surge, the impact of the storm surge, how many kilometers inland would the storm surge reach? How many kilometers inland, the height and cascading inland? I am certain that every LGU, that every padre de familia, that every person would have evacuated sooner. So communicating these things is so essential. Communicating it in the language understood by everyone. In fact, as author of the Pag-asa Modernization Act, I had hoped the intention of the bill, the law, is to modernize Pag-asa so that it gives accurate information and is more regionalized, so that the impact of the natural hazard in regions and in provinces can be localized. And the warnings, which should be not 24 hours before, but days before, 1 week before, should also be localized. And that is part of the Pag-asa Modernization Act. Because if this happened in November of 2013, I am certain that talikas ang tao and the 6,300 deaths would have been much, much less. But it is not the time for finger wagging. It is not the time to blame local governments or agencies of government. It is not the time to blame each other. It is a time to move forward for urgent climate action. And so, when we say we must climate-proof our communities, climate-proof our local governments, it means planting of mangroves, massive planting of trees, even the segregation of waste, recycling and composting is important so that floods do not ensue para ang ating mga daluyan ng tubig ay hindi rin puno ng basura. Para ang ating nabubulok ay maaring ilagay sa compost pit at maging organic fertilizer ang ating food waste at ang ating mga tuyot na dahon at lahat ng mga nabubulok or biodegradable. At yung mga bote, lata at plastic ay maaring iresikulo at magamit ng muli or ibenta. At yung mga latak or residual waste can go to the environment, sanitary landfill, and everything else, kukunti na ang ating mga ilalagay sa landfill. That is the essence of Republic Act 9003 or the Ecological Solid Waste Management Law. Also, it is important that every barangay, in fact, every sitio, every purok would have their DRR handbook. I will replicate my first aid handbook through the Climate Change Commission and the NDRIMC Council, which I used to give away, so that every barangay kagawad would have that and teach his or her constituents on what to do for preparedness. So I found it very timely that I would announce this today. I would have announced it on November 8th on the commemoration of Yolanda, but perhaps this is the best time to announce it. In the 2016 budget, as chairman of the Committee on Finance in the Senate, we allocated 50 million for the establishment of a climate resilience center. And we have been looking for land in Metro Manila, which is difficult, and so we decided that it will be in the government center here, as long as the land could be donated by the provincial government to the Climate Change Commission. And that's where the Philippine Advocacy Cooperative can have an office for training and for capacity building in your resilience center. So the Philippine Climate Change Commission, which has its offices in Malacañang and in the Ninoy Aquino Parks and Wildlife and Layo-Layo, can also have an office here. So you see here a collaboration between the national government agency and a region-based NGO with the local government for conferences, workshops, trainings for Region 8 and for other regions to come. We want it to be a green structure, green building, that would have a water catchment, that would have a gulayan or a forest garden of organic, grown vegetables, of forest trees around. All the elements of resilience must be contained in that Climate Resilience Center. It will be a project of the Climate Change Commission and the provincial government, and I requested Secretary Guzman to involve the Philippine Hayan Cooperative so that you will have a working area there and you can conduct capacity building workshops with the Climate Change Commission. Ayos ba yon, Pete? Only if you agree. So, I can go on and talk about the importance of resilience. But my appeal to you this morning is, let November 8th be a lesson for us on how we can rise again after disasters and let the unfortunate days stay in our memory. And to commemorate that, it would be best to make the lives of survivors and those who are living lives living in a resilient community. And so the best way we can do that is through the implementation of all the environmental laws that I just mentioned, and to operationalize all these laws with the assistance of the Climate Change Commission. And so I am asking the Climate Change Commission to conduct LGU community-based participatory workshops so the whole Region 8 will be resilient LGUs, and the whole region, not just Palo, not just Tacloban, but all the cities and the municipalities in Region 8 can be models of resilience for other LGUs all over the country. So that means that you will have to replicate all this and train trainers, so these trainers can go down to the barangay level and everybody would be a climate warrior, a DRR aware person, so that it will be taught in state universities and colleges, it will be taught in depth ed schools, it will be talked about by the barangay captain, it will be talked about by the tricycle driver. DRR, ano nga ba yung DRR? Ang paghahanda. Bawal magtapon dyan. Dapat magtanim dito. Bawal ang ganyang building. Ito dapat ang pagtayo. Ganun. Para so that we can see a change of lifestyle, a change in the way we think, in the way we see things, in the way we live. And that change will only come if both our leaders and you, our local community-based leaders, will implement all our laws. And so, on this occasion, I thank Pete Ilagan, Dr. Casas, and the local government of Tacloban and of Palo for inviting me to this workshop of your cooperative. And let today be the beginning of our journey towards a resilient, sustainable future for all of us. And let it be said that during our watch, as leaders of our nation, as leaders of our community, that we are able to use our time, our intellect, our wisdom, our power to make our communities safer, better, more sustainable, and resilient for this generation and the generations to come. Thank you very much. Magandang umaga sa inyo.